How do companies navigate, you know, one day, one hour it's one thing, and the next hour it's something different?
I think we saw over the last 3, 4, 5 years that every company was having to blend digital and physical because every product is connected. And the pandemic only accelerated that. I mean, even in education, we had to become experts in how to teach on Zoom overnight. And I think this is going to be with us on an ongoing basis. You'll see incumbent companies have to bring in digital capabilities, and disrupting companies have to understand what it's like to function in the real world.
So there are companies like, you know, Google, Apple, Uber pushing back the return to work. There are companies that are mandating mask mandates, mandating vaccinations, excuse me, like Facebook, like Google. Should companies be mandating vaccines at this point? Is that the only way this is going to change?
Right now, it appears that the Delta variant is actually hitting most people who are unvaccinated. And if the government isn't going to be able to do it, perhaps the only way that we'll be able to do it is that the private sector will have to force its people to get vaccinated if they want to come in. And they'll figure out how to blend who's in the office and who's not in the office. So this blending of digital and physical is going to be with us going forward.
One thing that I think is missing in a lot of the messaging is talk about kids under 12 who can't be vaccinated. And so even if you are vaccinated, there's a concern that you're taking, you know, whatever exposure you have at the office or on transport to the office back to your families. Like, how should companies be balancing all of that? I know they want people to get back to work, but it's scary for a lot of families.
Well, they're going to have to be open to the needs of their employees. Right? You know, if people who have young children, you have children. I see it on my colleagues at Stanford who have young children. It's really, really hard if you're worried about, are you going to get your kids sick? Will the kids, you know, end up spreading it to other people as well? So you'll see people, I think, take a more conservative view, which will slow the, you know, us getting back to the other side of what we hope will be a time when it's back to normal, when we're all out in public.
There are definitely people who are dying to get back to the office, and there are other people who are, honestly, on both sides, I find people who want to go back and are resentful that their companies are pushing back their returns to work, and others who are resentful that they feel that, like, their employers don't understand, you know, that they, you know, would like to stay home until this is truly over, which it's not. How do companies strike that balance, and what's going to separate the companies that get this right from the companies that get this wrong?
I think the best companies will, you know, employ what I talk about in the book, the amygdala, you know, the empathy towards their employees, and understand that different employees are going to need different things. People with young families are going to have to deal with health care, they're going to have to deal with child care, and you're going to have to create opportunities for them to be able to participate. Similarly, people who want to be able to come back in the office, maybe they're single, maybe they're younger, they like the social aspects that come from work, you want to be able to allow that to happen and to do so safely. Companies are going to need to be flexible, and they're going to need to know how to blend digital and physical together.
LinkedIn has called this the great reshuffle that's happening right now, where, you know, if employees aren't happy with what they're getting at work, they're going to go elsewhere and, you know, they'll find a place that meets their needs and desires. You know, describe how you see that playing out. Like, are we at a turning point where in a year, in 5 years, we're going to look back on this moment in work history and see the workforce has been forever changed?
Well, our species is social. We actually like being together. I mean, you and I can sit here together and have this conversation. It is better than on Zoom. On the other hand, you're going to have to enable flexibility. And I think flexibility is the key word. And companies that aren't flexible will lose talent. And as my colleague Jeff Immelt likes to say, talent is destiny. Mm-hmm. And so if you're not able to provide an environment where people have options and have choices, labor will go elsewhere.
What about the, sometimes I think the, you know, the qualities of individual and independent work are undervalued. There's a lot of creative inspiration that can happen individually. There's different kinds of work that can happen when you are alone and have uninterrupted time. How should companies take that into account? Because I feel like there can be or should be a balance of both.
Well, in the old days, you know, in the technology sector, Microsoft believed every engineer should have a door so they could enter the flow, and they'd enter exit five or six hours later with all the code they wrote. And now when people are side by side, you know, in desks, if you're an introvert, for example, that's not always the most productive place to be. Mm-hmm. And again, this comes back to flexibility. Companies are going to need to be able to understand sometimes people need quiet time, they need concentration time, and maybe being in the office is not necessary.